little boy in a baseball hat stands in the field with his ball and bat. Says, I am the greatest player of them all. Puts his bat on his shoulder and he tosses up his ball. And the ball goes up and the ball comes down, swings his bat all the way around. The world's so still you can hear the sound. The baseball falls to the ground. Now the little boy doesn't say a word, picks up his ball, he is undeterred. Says, I am the greatest there has ever been. And he grits his teeth and he tries it again. And the ball goes up and the ball comes down, swings his bat all the way around. The world's so still you can hear the sound. Baseball fight. Something like that.
Steel third perfect. The designated hitter, number 15, Nick Maiolo.
Thank you. Silly, that ball is gone. Nick Maiolo with his third home run of the season. And the lead is back to 6 for the Yellow Jackets. They go in front 7-1. It looked like Maiolo got underneath that. Still had enough carry to make it out near the 330 cent. Maiolo with a one-out homer in the ninth.
On the line, and he gives his all one last time. And the ball goes up like the moon so bright, swings his bat with all his might. And the world's as still can be, and the baseball falls. And that's strike three. Now it's supper time, and his mama calls. Little boy starts home with his bat and ball. Says I am the greatest, that is a fact. But even I didn't know I could pitch like that. Up and the ball comes down, swings his bat all the way around. The world's so still you can hear the sound. The baseball falls to the ground. He makes no excuses, he shows no fear. He just closes his eyes and listens to the cheer. Little boy, he adjusts his hat, picks up his ball, stares at his bat, says I am the greatest, the game is on the line, and he gives his all one
designated hitter, number 15, Nick Maiolo.
Thank you.
goes up and the ball comes down. Swings his bat all the way around. The world's so still you can hear the sound. The baseball falls to the ground. He makes no excuses. He shows no fear. He just closes his eyes and listens to the cheer.
Pitch to Lodge upstairs, and he'll take a walk.
That's the second walk of the game that Lodge has taken. He's back on base. Randolph Macon has done this a couple of times. They've gotten the guy on, the leading run on, and they just keep making outs.
Randolph Macon 2-0 in extra inning affairs. 10 innings against Guilford in game one of a doubleheader by the score of 2-1, and then down at Christopher Newport, they knocked off the Captains 6-5 in 13 innings.
And we're at the top of the 13th, aren't we?
Yep. The Yellow Jackets actually with a tie to their record as well this year. 2-2. Hot still on the hill. Came in the 8th. Pitch is upstairs. He's essentially having a start.
Yes, he's
at
essentially
this point.
At right now it's all, and it is a quality start at this point.
6 innings of work.
Yeah.
Well, this being his 6th.
He's done a heck of a job. Got to give him credit. Big nods to him and the starter from Randolph Macon today, Colin Selby.
Selby went 9. And Koch has tossed the last 3.
Yeah, how about that? 9 innings and you get a no decision.
Coming into the game, Koch has thrown in 17 games and only tossed 20 and a third innings. So he's being pushed a little bit as that pitch is called strike 1-2.
Nick Maiolo, who's at the plate right now, crushed a ball in the left into right center field. If he can hit that ball there again, I said this the last time Travis Lodge was on first, he could score.
Macon has put runners on in the 11th and 12th. Pitch to Maiolo is upstairs 2-2. Bodies are in the Shenandoah bullpen. Don't know if they're warm.
Well,
nobody throwing right now.
Gentleman in the hoodie, he looks pretty warm, pretty content.
2-2. Lodge removing Maiolo, base hit. Lodge will have to stop at second as it was knocked right to Joe Coleman in center. Nobody out, runners on first and second.
Well, the heads-up play there by Lodge gets him into second very easily. If he's not running, Coleman has a chance to throw him out for a 4, so that's a really, really good execution of the hit and run there by Randolph Macon.
One, one. Keeler gets that one down. It's a good one. Nowhere to go except for first, and the ball gets away. Goes into the Macon pen. Orocho comes in. One run is in on his horse. For the second run is Maiolo. And winding up all the way at third base is Keeler. So an E5. And it will be the 5th error of the day for the Hornets.
Well, Robert Marchell, who came in at third base in the last inning, he made a really nice stop to end the inning after a double play. And right there, he turned around to third looking for a throw. He didn't have it, and then he just threw the ball too short. It got by Nussman. And, Bob, I said it earlier, whoever blinks first, that might decide who will win the game. And, well, Shenandoah just blinked first.
And Nussman's done a good job picking today, but could not pick that when it got all the way into the Randolph Macon bullpen. The bullpen scattered to give Orocho room to get up there. It's 4-2.
Nick Maiolo, when he came across the plate, he was all fired up. He looked like a football player who just made the best sack of his career. He looked like Patrick Willis used to, the former 49ers linebacker. after making a big defensive play.
No outs, and the Keeler's on third. Pitch to Trinum, who came in the seventh inning, is now seeing his fourth at bat. 0-1.
In his first at bat, he hit a shot right off of Hott's foot for a single.
Grounded to second. Baker looks the runner back, gets the out. Andoa, who had zero losses going into the final last year, lost one, then knocked off Wesley. And Coleman gets it up the middle, off the mound. Stepped on for at short. The throw at first, not in time. They'll say it pulled. Travis Lodge off the bag. So fielder's choice. Butler got the lead man. There's one down.
Butler made an amazing play just staying in front of that ball. It looked more routine than it actually was. He made a great move over to second to step on to second to get the force out. What happened was the slide from Murray made him throw the ball very high, and it pulled Travis Lodge off the bag. As it looks like...
You want to make sure you know what you're doing here.
Right, absolutely. Keeler is going out to the mound to go talk to his pitcher to make sure everyone's on the same page.
It was more just a shoulder slap for Coke saying, you got it, buddy. One pitch, again, game over. Baker. Baker grounds it to third, but foul. 0-1. Orocho would be next. Don't think Randolph Macon really wants to see Lowe, even though he has been quiet this game, 1 out of 5.
You want to get that big bat. No other reason to come up to the plate the rest of this night.
Coke's pitch hits the outside corner, 0-2.
Now you got 2 strikes. Got to cut down on your swing a little bit if you're Tristan Baker, but you got to hit the ball. If it's anywhere close, you have to at least foul it off.
Baker's won the collar in game 9 of the ODAC tournament, 0-for-4 with a walk. Keeler setting up outside the 0-2. Baker chops it to short. Butler will play it on the hop. Flips for one. Azor will eat it. Has Randolph Macon's just playing one out at a time.
That's another fielder's choice. Very same play. The only difference this time is that Azor didn't have a chance to really throw on to first. So he wisely hangs on to the ball. And now Abel Orocho is the final hope for the defending champs.
So Orocho represents the tying run. On first is Baker. Pitch from Coke. In there for a strike, 0-1.
Taking a few practice cuts before he steps back into the box. Orocho trying to keep this game going.
The 0-1. Lifted in the air. Should do it. Sanderson runs in on it. Squeezes it. Macon has eliminated Shenandoah.
So you got to be careful if you want to waste a pitch if you're Coke. Don't let it get in the dirt. Make sure Keeler can catch it and keep Johnson at second. That one swung on. Lodge, the player of the year, comes up with it. Drives over to first base. And that's all she wrote. The Tigers made a valiant effort to come back, scoring 4 runs in the final 2 innings to make it a 5-6 game. But Christian Coke gets the final out. The grounder to first. Lodge comes up with it, jogs over to first, and the Randolph Macon Yellow Jackets, the 2 seed, sweep the tournament field, go 4-0, and win the 2016 ODAC Championship.
Let's go!
Now now for 8 Sports. April showers are bringing us May flowers for Randolph Macon Yellow Jackets to add more accomplishments to their already stellar 2016 baseball season. On the first day of May, Macon had the last word in the ODAC tournament. The baseball championship game in Lynchburg, Randolph Macon battling Hampton Sydney, bottom six, runner at third for Stuart Brown, crushing it down the left field line. It is fair, and Michael Trenton comes home. Jackets get three in the frame for a 5-1 lead. Tigers plenty of fight in the eighth as Lee Carnell bombed a left over the fence. Two-run blast pulls Hampton Sydney close at 6-3. Ninth and error, and a ball pulls the Tigers within one, but Brian Goodwin grounds out to first, and Randolph Macon wins its fourth ODAC baseball title in the last 8 years, 6-5 over Hampton Sydney.
Felt like if we could get into the middle of the game, fifth, sixth inning, that we'd be able to wear them down, we'd be able to put some good at-bats together. But all in all, I couldn't be prouder of our guys. I mean, that's the perseverance and resiliency that we've shown all year. And
oh, it's awesome. Playing from my friends and family, it's a blessing. It's really fun. It's the last one ever, and it's going to be awesome. I'm going to miss all these guys. It's been a blast, and I'll never forget it.
Nick Maiolo, the designated hitter, stepping in. He also reached on an error in the second inning, came around to score on a double to right center by Mike Trentum. That was the game's first run in the second inning. Maiolo 0-2. First pitch is low for a ball. One run already across here in the bottom of the fifth as Rick Spires with a bunt single and a three-base error that allowed him to go all the way around to score. And that one's driven high and deep to the left center field gap, and this ball is gone. A home run for designated hitter Nick Maiolo, and the score is now 4-5-0.
Well, that one just plopped right over in left center field. I mean, it had to be right over that fence.
But regardless, that's the seventh home run of the season for Nick Maiolo, and the score is now 5-0.
From Randolph Macon College, we have head coach Ray Hedrick and student athletes James Walsh and Nick Maiolo. Coach, opening remarks.
This is a proud night for our program. 39 years since Randolph Macon first made an appearance in the NCAA regionals, and it's our first win at that level for the program. So, proud to do this for Hugh Stevens, Greg Waters, all the coaches and players that have put on the uniform before, proudly for Randolph Macon College, and really happy for this group to be the first group to do it. Just another notch in their belt on a successful year. But really, really excited for everybody involved with Randolph Macon baseball tonight.
Was there any pressure hanging to this game knowing that you haven't won a regional game in school history?
I don't think so. I mean, maybe internally for me there was some pressure. The senior class was in a regional in 2013, lost 3-2. In the last inning against Salisbury at that time, and then lost 5-0 the next day to Huntington. So I think they had that taste in their mouths, and they knew that this was going to be big, and that this team was a little bit different. So I think initially there was the butterflies. I think initially there was a little bit of apprehension because we didn't know a lot about St. Joe's, and we didn't know what we were going to get, and we were a little rusty having not played for 2 weeks. But I think once we settled in, I think that apprehension turned into some confidence, and I'm always apprehensive, these guys will tell you, but I think we felt pretty good going into the middle of the game.
James, you got the career high in strikeouts for you, about 15 out of the 30 batters you faced. When did you realize you were in the zone? Was it during the game? Could you tell that you were going to be on before the game in bullpen? When did you realize that this could be a very good night for you?
Well, I felt really good in my bullpen. And then obviously it translated over to the game. After the first inning, I got the nerves out of me, and then I felt like I was in the zone early in the second inning.
All right, and Nick, you had a big blow tonight, big home run. What's that like, hitting the home run in the regional? And offensively, how do you think you guys did as a team moving forward into tomorrow?
Well, like Coach said, it was our first regional win, and James did a great job giving us an opportunity to score runs. And like Coach Rhodes said, it was a hit here, hit there, run here, run there. But when we really started to string it together, it was just easy to play behind James when you have a performance like that, and it was real nice.
Nick, talk about what you being a catcher, what you saw from James, even though you're in the dugout, but just what you saw from him.
It was incredible. So even though I'm not catching, I'm still trying to call pitches and still seeing if I still got it. And James, it just looks like he's just hitting every spot. And looks, I mean, his curveball looked incredible today. Fastball hitting spots, he was just in the zone.
James, can you talk about what was the difference from your last start, not having any strikeouts in the ODAC tournament game, and then getting 15 tonight?
I think it was just my command. I really didn't feel like I had my command last start in the ODAC, and today I just felt all my pitches I had command of, and it just felt good.
Nick Maiolo is also hitting back-to-back innings. He had to follow the three-run home run by Travis Lodge in his last at-bat, so he's getting the bat with a runner on here. No balls, one strike on Nick Maiolo. Pitcher is Justin Johnson. He looks in at Shane Roebuck, takes the sign and fires. That's a strike. 0-2. Once again, another squiggly line and up in the seventh inning for Randolph Macon.
Yeah, that's three innings in a row. Good pitcher's pitch there is what I was about to say. Out of Justin Johnson.
That ball's lifted high and deep to left center field. That ball is gone. That one hit the trees back there. A good swing of the bat there by Nick Maiolo. Looks like he just kind of reached down and golfed that one. That one might have been at the knees. And two runs will score as the third home run of the day for the Randolph-Macon Yellow Jackets.
From Randolph-Macon College, head coach Ray Hedrick and student athletes James Walsh and Nick Maiolo. Coach, your opening remarks.
Tough time to have our first losing streak of the season. But I first want to thank everybody from Wash and Jefferson and the surrounding schools for putting on a great tournament. We were fortunate to be part of such a well-run first-class event. And, you know, it's tough to go out this way. I can't say enough, and I told our team, I mean, to be 35-8, we set so many different program records, regular season, postseason. Really proud of my team and what they've been able to accomplish. Could not be prouder of our senior class, and two of them are to my left. But the class of 2016 did everything that we set out to do when they were recruited in 2012. And I know this is a tough feeling for them right now and for the rest of the team, but they're going to be enjoying some benefits of their hard work as this program continues to move forward.
Coach, early on in the game, it seems like both teams were not wanting to make that one mistake to lose this. Do you feel like you guys were a little too tight or tentative with some of the maybe base running or not going base to base?
No, I don't think. I mean, I think there was the butterflies initially in the apprehension of being in a championship game. I think we were still a little hungover, so to speak, from last night, just in terms of the, you know, I mean, we were 90 feet away multiple times from winning the game, and it didn't work out our way, and then they had such a big inning. But, I think once, you know, James settled in the first inning and we came out of there unscathed, I think our guys built their confidence. They just pitched us well. I mean, I'm not going to say that our hitters did a bad job. I think our hitters always do a good job. I think Chase would tell you, and any coach in this tournament or anybody we've played this year would say that our hitters are, you know, very disciplined and they put together very tough at-bats. And I don't think this tournament or these past 2 days have been any different. I think they just pitched us well.
And what went into the decision to take James out of the game in the seventh inning there?
I mean, James and I have been talking since the fourth inning about, you know, his where he was and how his body was feeling. You know, generally our starters are on a 6 or 7 day routine throughout the course of the season. And, you know, obviously James pitched on Wednesday and coming back on Sunday. That's the shortest rest he's had all year. He did have one other time between a Saturday doubleheader and the beginning of the conference tournament on Thursday against Virginia Wesleyan. I felt like we needed to get at least five out of James. I was hoping we would have a little bit more offense today. Again, not putting our guys down, but saying they pitched us well. But once he got us through six, I mean, actually, we were going to shut it down at five, and then he came in and said, I got another one in me. But I would like to think James would agree. I mean, he gave it everything he had on short rest, showed why he is arguably the best pitcher in the South region and maybe one of the best pitchers in the country. And, you know, I mean, it's I think we, you know, we need to do a few more things and not put it necessarily on the decision to take out James or put it on James. He's given us everything he's got.
Is that a goal that you set for yourself?
Well, I'm not going to lie. It was in the beginning of the season I set goals. I wanted 100-plus strikeouts, and I was just thankful I got the opportunity to get that.
Nick, you guys have accomplished a lot in your 4 years at Randolph Macon. You broke the single-season record for wins in the season. You guys eclipsed the 100-win mark as a senior group. What has this been like, the whole experience?
Words can't even describe it. Man, it is great to put on this uniform every day and play. It doesn't matter. There's such a rich history. And to be the first to get to 100 wins, to go to a regional, to win a regional game, all that stuff, I mean, it's always a great day to be a YJ. It just feels good. I love putting on the uniform. And, man, I wish that it was going a little longer, but it's just baseball.
Nick, talk about where you've seen the program come from when you came in as a freshman to right now.
It's grown remarkably. When we were freshmen, we won the tournament off a tie. We got in the tournament off a tie, and we came to regional, and we were desperate for that first win, and didn't get it freshman year, and then sophomore year, same goals, but didn't get it junior year, same thing. And then this year, there was something different with this group, I felt, and we really played well as a team. It's like one big family, and it's really nice to see the program grow the way it did, and hopefully we're the stepping stone for more to come.
I think it's going to help in numerous ways. I think it's going to help us from a recruiting standpoint and attracting quality student athletes and getting people more excited about what is already an exciting time to be in Ashland at Randolph-Macon. I mean, what our president has done for that college and, you know, just the administration there. It's a great, you know, we've got a great education. We're located right in the middle of the state, and we have facilities academically and athletically that are second to none, especially from a liberal arts standpoint in the state of Virginia. You know, from within the program, these seniors have you know, they've left their mark, and I'm hoping, and I brought some of the younger guys, the second year, third year guys together while LaRoche was celebrating. I said, you know, the page has turned, and now it's your time to lead and soak this in, because I'd like to think in the next couple of years we'll have this opportunity again, and, you know, moments like this will define, you know, where our program will be. So, you know, on the field, I'd like to think that this is a stepping stone for success, you know, beyond, but certainly I think our seniors have left this program in better shape than it was before they got here.
Any other questions?
James, can you just talk about the development of the pitching staff over these past 3 years and where you see them?
I mean, we've grown tremendously. I know when I transferred in here my first year, we had a pitching coach, and to see where I came in and we started at to now, it's unbelievable. All the things that coach has done to help us out, all the throwing routines and stuff like that. I just think our bullpen is second to none.
Take me out to the ball game. Swing, better swing, better swing, better swing, yeah. Swing, better swing, better swing, better swing, yeah. next in line. Swing, batter, batter, swing, batter, batter, swing, batter, batter, swing. Swing, batter, batter, swing, batter, batter, swing, batter, batter, swing. Why, yes, I went to Harvard.
Little boy in a baseball hat stands in the field with his ball and bat. Says, I am the greatest player of them all. Puts his bat on his shoulder and he tosses up his ball.